Please stand as we pray together our liturgy of celebration. In the beginning was God, creating, giving birth to the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and in darkness, but God spoke into the emptiness and light appeared, the dawn of our beginnings. God kept creating flowers, trees, seeds, and fruit. Things that blossom and things that grow, God created more. Life that crawled and life that swam, life that sprang on hooves and life that soared on wings. From the midst of this earth came yet another creature, created in God's image. There in the bounty of the garden, God created humanity, male and female. God breathed into them life-giving breath. God looked upon these creatures with love and said, "It is good." Then God rested, seeing and loving what had been done, setting free this creation with all its potential for good and evil.
Gracious God, thank you for the goodness of creation, for the variety, the beauty, and the delicate complexity of life, your creation. Forgive us for the times we have not appreciated or cared for all you have given to us. Open our eyes, restore our hearts, and bring us back.
The diversity of life is nowhere more profound than among human beings. We are many colors, shapes, and ages. Language, music, culture, and custom vary among us. We are a great tapestry woven from God's love. Artful weaver, you ask that we share your love with others, just as Jesus reached out and loved those most different from himself. Too often we fall short of this call, seeing differences as cause for fear rather than for celebration. Instead of caring for the tapestry, we unravel the fabric of your design. We perpetuate divisions by race and color, culture, class, and gender.
Thank you.
Jesus healed the sick, fed the hungry, gave hope to the hopeless. Jesus challenges his followers to continue his ministry, asking us to feed, clothe, and give shelter, saying, "As you do these things for the least of these, you do them for me." We remember the birthday of the church, when the people who had gathered for prayer and praise were filled with the Holy Spirit. We remember how the Spirit came upon them like fire, like wind, surrounding them, exciting them, opening their eyes and hearts to the power and presence of God. The Spirit-filled church could not stop singing praises to God, reaching out to each other's need, spreading the word of God's power and God's love. We remember this beginning and pray that the church will be infused with new life through the Spirit, calling us, claiming us, summoning us to the excitement and joy of faith. As God created the heavens, the earth, and life itself, may God give birth to new life in us. May God's love be known to us today through Jesus Christ. And as tiny pebbles thrown into a pond cause ripples to move outward in ever-widening circles, may our love move from this place outward, expanding to embrace our neighbors, our community, our human family, and our world. And good morning, everyone. We're glad that you're joining us here on this Sunday, August 6th, And here are some announcements for you. To begin with, we need to make a little correction of something that's in your bulletin. That was not Donna Mulholland playing with Franklin Nifong. That was Mona Kettner. And I'll bet if we took a poll and asked how many of you could claim Come Thou Fount as your favorite hymn, there would be a few who would. So thank you very much. What a great duo and backup, of course. Now, Evie has some announcements about Christian education.
Good morning, friends. This evening, there is a very important meeting coming up of the Faith Formation Team. It's at 7 o'clock in the Friendship Room to get us ready to roll into this next school year. If you're already involved in children's ministries, please plan to attend. If you think you might be interested in getting involved and coming on board in this vital ministry, please come check it out, 7 o'clock in the Friendship Room. Next, with regard to our next Sunday, many families will be traveling up to Laurel Ridge for our worship up there, so there will be no children's Sunday school and no youth Sunday school because we'll be on the mountain. Adult Sunday school classes. Talk with your class this morning and decide. You decide whether you want to meet with your class or not based on how many folks will be here and how many folks will be up at Laurel Ridge. So that is your choice for next Sunday. We hope you will join us either at Laurel Ridge on the mountain or here at New Philadelphia as we celebrate the August 13th festival.
And for those of you who will remain down from the mountain and right here, we will be meeting one service, 9:30, where we will, as Evie said, celebrate Holy Communion and the festival of August 13th. Last Sunday, Evie and Pastor Sam took us through centuries of history in a very short time. Now, as we prepare for fall, there are many new things to anticipate. Evie has an announcement about youth.
Good morning, church. Thanks. So on August 20th, it's a Sunday, we are having our fall kickoff for our rising sixth graders and our rising seniors. It's going to be the best time. I highly recommend coming out. We always need adult help if you'd like to help with it. We're going to have all kinds of water sports and water games, kickball, slip and slides, you name it, we'll have it. Come prepared to get wet, because if you're not wet, you're not having fun in the summer. Am I right? I think I'm right. And we're also going to have great food, great friends, and a whole lot of Jesus. So that's for our rising sixth graders, through our rising 12th graders. But truly, if you just want to help out, we'd love to see you there. It would just be a great time for everyone. So that's August 20th, 5 p.m. to 7:30. Can't wait to see you.
Thanks, Abby. Now, here's a preview of some other things coming up fairly soon. September 14th. Antiques Roadshow. I think in the church newsletter it gave a different date, but just mark your calendars for the 14th. If you have never come to this, or if you think, oh, I don't have anything interesting to bring, I assure you, you are wrong. Every time we get together and people show their treasures, we laugh a lot and learn things about each other that we would never have known otherwise. And so, please come on the 14th, 9:30, down in the banquet room. We'll have coffee to start, and then we'll have a program with lunch to follow, barbecue, red and white slaw. So, for some of you, it makes a difference, I know. Also, there will be a Chrismon workshop in October. Now, next Sunday, I will have scripture passages for you to choose among as you volunteer for this year's Advent Devotion Guide. I know it seems like it's early, but really, it's time to start planning these things. Our theme is Little Lord Jesus, and we're doing something a little different this year. You may choose one of the pre-selected scriptures which say something about the birth of Jesus, or you may choose to write about a phrase or a verse of your favorite Christmas carol. So start thinking about that, and I'll have everything ready for you next Sunday. In your bulletin, you saw this insert. On behalf of the Stewardship Committee, I'm happy to say that our theme this year is Giving It's Personal, as indeed it is. And we want to know, in fact, our printed material will be based on your responses to the question, this is why I give, or why do you give? There's a place for you to write something down here, and we would like to use your statements in our brochure. And so if you're willing to do that and give us permission, you'll see that everything we need is here. I'll be in the commons area following the service, and if you'd hand those to me, I would surely appreciate it. And by the way, while you have your pencils out, please reach for a pew pad and let us know that you are here today. Now, last announcement. Last week, you learned about our grant of $25,000 from the Moravian Ministries Foundation, and that is earmarked for our Cancer Benevolence Fund, specifically for food insecurity. The check for $25,000 arrived this week on Thursday. On Friday, we made our first disbursement. Cynthia Farrington learned of a woman with breast cancer. She will be receiving radiation and chemo into November. And so she came into the office on Friday to receive gift cards for food. Our blessing box doesn't stock everything that folks need. And so we were able to help her with gift cards. She had just come from her chemotherapy treatment. And I can tell you that her gratitude was humbling, and it was a really divine moment to be able to help her in this way. So thanks to everyone who supports all of these wonderful things that allow us to make such a difference in the lives of those we serve. And now, can we pray? Heavenly Father, in the words of the old hymn, this morning we stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love us, sinners, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful our songs shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is the Savior's love for me. This morning, Lord, we do stand amazed in the presence of the one who loves us enough to save us and who loves us enough to heal us. We give special praise this morning for those who have felt your presence and strong hands as they have recovered from surgeries and accidents and maladies that required the touch of the great physician. We think of Paul and Catherine and Tim and others whom we know and don't know who have experienced your touch. We ask mercy and care for those with upcoming surgeries this week, for Shannon and for Paul and for all who are in need of care. We ask that your hands would guide surgeons and caregivers so that what we receive from each other is truly coming from you. Lord, forgive us when we fail to be amazed enough at your power and your strength as you guide our paths and direct our ways. May our songs of praise never cease as we contemplate your marvelous and wonderful works. We ask all of these things in the powerful and holy and perfect name of Jesus. Amen. And now, as always, every Sunday we have an opportunity to give our tithes and offerings to the Lord, and you may do that through offering plates always available for you in the narthex of the church, or through secure online portals.
Forever blessed is he who serves the Lord. Forever, forever blessed is he.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, forever blessed are we as we serve you in our world. On this morning, we pray for new strength and renewed vision that we might know more surely our role in building your kingdom here on earth. In the name of Jesus, amen.
This first scripture comes from the prophet Isaiah, and it is extra important to this morning's sermon, so I highly recommend paying a little extra attention, hint, hint, wink, wink. You can find it on page 598 in your pew Bibles. It's from Isaiah chapter 55, verses 1 through 5. Oh, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you that have no money, come. Buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. And the second comes out of the letter of Romans, chapter 9, verse 1 through 5. It's on page 920 in your pew Bibles. I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all. God blessed forever. Amen.
Thank you.
So, in just a few minutes, Pastor Dave up there is going to share a story with the congregation. And it's about a little boy who had a basket, and he had some food. He had some bread, and he had some fish. Not very much. So, here's the deal. Jesus was out on a hillside, and he started teaching people. He started talking, and people kept coming and sitting down and listening, and more people kept coming and sitting down and listening, and more people came and sat down. Soon they had 5,000 of people, way, way, way more than we even have here. Lots and lots and lots of people. And it got to be about dinner time, and they started getting hungry. And the disciples went to Jesus and said, "These people got to go home. We need to get dinner." And Jesus said, "You feed them." They went, "What am I going to feed them?" So they started walking around the crowd and looking for food. Well, there wasn't very much there, but they saw this one little boy, and he had a basket that looked kind of like this. Let's give that little boy a name. What do you think his name was? Beauregard? What was his name? What do you want to call him? Jack Jr.? Billy Bob? Let's do Billy Bob. Billy Bob. Okay. Billy Bob was on the hillside, and he had a basket, and it looked something like this. How many loaves of bread are in there? Count them. 5. And how many fish? 2. 5 loaves and 2 fish. And thousands of hungry people. Would that little basket even feed all the people in here? Ooh, no. So that little boy, he didn't think that he had very much to offer, but he gave it to Jesus' friends, the disciples, hoping it would help some. Now, does anyone remember what Pastor Sam's 2 favorite words are that he talks about in the Bible? But God. So through Jesus, God took that little basket with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, and he lifted it up and he blessed it. And he started breaking the loaves of bread to handing them out. Gave it all to the disciples. And they kept breaking it and handing out to people and giving them fish, breaking more bread, and handing out and giving it. And you know what? That basket, that little basket with 5 loaves and 2 fish, never got empty. God just kept putting more in it and multiplying it so that everybody had something to eat, and everybody would realize that Jesus was super special. Now, think about Billy Bob, our friend, the little boy. He didn't think he had enough to help. It was just 5 little loaves of bread and 2 fish. But he gave it up, even though it meant he might not have dinner. He gave it up selflessly and said, "Okay, well, here, God can use it." And he gave it away. Jesus blessed it, and now he had helped in a miracle and helped God. So because he was selfless, God used his gift and made something amazing happen with it. A whole hillside full of people had something to eat and learned that Jesus was super special. Now, there's something really cool, one more really cool thing about this story, because it doesn't stop there. Do you know that you and I can help God even if we think there's nothing super special about us? I don't have a superpower. I can't do a lot. Do you think sometimes, there's nothing special about me. I can't do anything great for God. But God can use your gifts and your hands and your feet and your heart to help out other people and do really cool things. So if we give God the gift of ourselves and our hands and our feet and our energy and our heart, we can make amazing things happen too. We may not think we're enough, but just like Billy Bob, God can use it and make something really amazing happen. So let's ask God to help us this week to do just that. Will you pray with me? Dear God, thanks for the story of the little boy who was willing to share. Thanks for using him and helping us to know that you can use us too, even if we think we're not enough. Use us this week and every day to share your light and your love to the people around us. We love you.
Our reading from Matthew comes just after Jesus has learned about the death of John the Baptist. Now, when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish." And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled, and they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. We're going to be focusing on that passage from Isaiah this morning. And before we do, I have to give you a little bit of a history lesson. In 586 BC, King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon sent his armies into Judea. They captured the city of Jerusalem. They looted and destroyed the temple. They forcibly deported the political and spiritual leaders and most of the people to Babylon. It was a traumatic end to more than 400 years of the Davidic monarchy. And it produced a crisis of identity for God's people. In the words of the psalmist, Psalm 137, spoken in Babylon, "How can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land?" And so our reading from Isaiah 55 comes from the period about 50 years after the event I just described. 50 years after King Nebuchadnezzar came. Exile in Babylon, a foreign land. It was probably long enough for people to give up on the idea of ever returning home. Maybe things would never return to normal if they even could remember what normal was. Were they still God's covenant people? Or was it all just a dream? Perhaps they'd grown weary, weary of jumping at all the rumors of new and better political conditions, every whispered hope about some improved economy, every passing story about returning one day to Jerusalem. 50 years, perhaps they'd been too long in exile. And one way to deal with that disappointment would be to just give up hope. And yet the prophet sees something on the horizon. This exile is soon going to end. Cyrus of Persia has already defeated the Medes and the Lydians, and now he's got Babylon in his sight for conquest. There is hope for the future. Cyrus is seen, in the words of the Old Testament, as God's instrument of liberation. He's God's shepherd. He's God's redeemer. So this immediate future holds such great promise, including the return to Jerusalem. But how do you get people to see that? How do you get them to see? So Isaiah issues an invitation for Israel to come to God for relief from all of these woes and for a renewal of their life by the free offer of divine grace. He talks about feasting. He talks about the word of God. He talks about a covenant. Feasting. Through the prophet, the voice of God calls 3 times, if you listen carefully, saying, "Come. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you that have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread and your labor for that which does not satisfy?" I have to admit that the first word of that is kind of strange. Ho! You don't often hear that these days. The Hebrew word is more like hoi. I was thinking about courtroom language. Oh, yay, oh, yay, you know, and when they start the court proceedings, it's like, what's that word? It's just weird. This word basically means, hey, Listen up. It's like, oh yeah, it's like, hear ye, listen to what's being said. And what's being said is, this little narrative here is God's voice crying out to the people. And he's cast in the role of a street vendor, selling wares, selling things to eat and drink. And surprisingly, he's offering the food and the drink at no cost. You know, there are few places in the world where that happens. I was thinking of, there's a place in Asheville on King Street. You may know it. It's called Farm, F-A-R-M. It's a restaurant. Been there for a while. Started by one woman who realized there are a lot of hungry people in the area. F-A-R-M stands for Food for All, Regardless of Means. And that's what's going on here in this text. Isaiah says, it's a banquet. Water and wine and milk and bread, the staples of life in the Near East. It's a banquet, and it's free. Don't waste your money and your hard work on something that does not satisfy. Come to a free banquet of the Lord's abundance. That's what's in store for you as his people. Prophet talks about the word. Beyond the banquet, Israel is invited to feast, if you will, on God's word. He says, listen carefully to me and eat what is good and delight yourselves in rich food, never minding the cholesterol. No, that's not in there, is it? Incline your ear and come listen to me. Come to me. Listen so that you may live. There's that invitation again. Come to me. Listen so that you may live. And this word listen here is the same word that's used in the foundational prayer of the people of God. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. The invitation is not just to listen like you listen to Spotify or, you know, something on the radio maybe. It's not just to let the sounds go in your ear. It includes this idea of heeding, paying attention to what is being spoken, and following God's word, which the prophet says is the source of life. And you know, with the temple destroyed and with kingship ended, one of the big questions for the people in exile was, what happened to the covenant between God and his people? And in particular, what about that covenant made with David that his royal line was going to continue forever? What about that? The prophet says, I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. God is reaffirming and reestablishing that basic covenant bond. I will be your God, and you will be my people. And what's just astounding here is who he's making the covenant with. He says, I will make with you. In the South, we would say, all y'all. I am making with you, not just the king, but with all people. I am making an everlasting covenant. The prophet declares that this relationship with God is not broken. It's not forgotten. God's love for Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and David and for his own people has been there all along, and it's going to continue without end. And the actual wording is even more tender than it seems. It's not, God doesn't really say, I will make. He says, let me make an everlasting covenant with you. Even though they've strayed from their relationship with God, even though they have suffered the consequences of exile, God is right there, ready to renew the covenant, to restore the relationship. Wow, this prophet's message is something. A new day is dawning. Feed on the abundance of God that is freely provided in his grace. Listen to and follow God's word, which is the word of life. Live in the everlasting covenant of God, the covenant that God is renewing with his people. Sounds pretty inviting, maybe encouraging, even hopeful. But wait, there's more. there's more. The prophet invited the people to listen. Now he's inviting them to look, to see, and to receive a commission. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. The prophet declares that Israel is once again going to be an earthly sign of the Lord, the God of Israel. Other peoples and nations will turn to them, no, even run to them. God's people will be a reflection of God's glory in the world. That's their purpose. That's their calling. That's their commission, is what the prophet says. All of this is going to happen because of the Lord, their God, who has glorified them. And if you listen carefully to the passage and what I've been saying here, you kind of pick out some action words. They're almost commands in the reading. Come, buy without price, eat, listen, delight. And all of these words are words of participation. Food and drink become part of your body. And so the words of the prophet, the message that we're listening to today, should be fully embraced. It should be entered into. Because if you feast on God's abundance, if you work to make the good news of this return from exile your own, if you think about yourself as being a beacon of God's love in the world, you receive the gift of life. You know, we've not seen our homes and our house of worship destroyed, and we certainly haven't been in exile for 50 years, but we have been going through quite a lot together, haven't we? The COVID virus is still out there. It finally got me back in May. Not to mention social inequalities and unrest, political turmoil, economic uncertainty, environmental crisis. I think I'll stop there. You know, we face significant challenges, and these things raise questions about who we are and what the future holds for us, and where is God in all of this? So maybe these words from 2,500 years ago could speak to us even today. As we face uncertainty and challenge and turmoil in our day, what would happen if we chose to live in the abundance of God's grace and not fritter away our money and our time on things that don't satisfy? What would happen if we listen to God's word, what God is saying to us, not only hearing it but heeding it with our actions and following that word, which is the word of life? What if we accepted God's invitation to live in that eternal covenant of God's love as God's people? What if we got to work fulfilling that commission to be a sign, a light to the nations, so that they are attracted to what we are sharing and doing, and more importantly, drawn to the Lord our God, the Holy One of Israel? You know, next Sunday is August the 13th, the festival of our church. It's actually going to be celebrated on the date. That doesn't happen very often. And Moravians worldwide are going to come to the Lord's table for Holy Communion. You know, in the old days, to get ready for communion, our ancestors had a practice that was called speaking. In those days, and it's a long time ago, but in those days, leading up to Holy Communion, the pastors and the elders would circulate in the community to have one-on-one conversations with the members about their walk with the Savior and their readiness, their preparation to receive the sacrament. Now, over the years, we've managed to compress that. There used to be speaking, what I just described, and then for a while there were preparatory services to Holy Communion. So like if we're doing communion this Sunday, on Thursday night, there was a special service preparing us for communion. And some of us may remember, and in some places, even in the mission field, you went to Thursday service preparatory and you got a card that admitted you to communion on Sunday. Most of us remember the little cards we filled out sometimes in church and put in the offering plate to prove that we were doing communion. We used to do that, you know. That's kind of a holdover from that. So it went from speaking to having a special service to having a preparatory liturgy. Look in the red book, liturgy preparatory to Holy Communion, right there. And then it's gotten to the point where we offer a prayer of confession in the midst of a communion service. But the point I want to make here is we Moravians have taken this thing pretty seriously through the years. We prepare ourselves for the Lord's Supper. So how about if we use this week and this text as a preparatory to Holy Communion next week? How are we living into the abundance of God's grace? How are we listening to God's word, hearing it, heeding it, and following it to life? How are we accepting the invitation to be in relationship, covenant relationship with God? What might we be doing to fulfill God's commission to be a sign and a light to the nations, reflecting God's glory, reflecting God's love to a world in need? I invite you to stand for our closing hymn, Your Hands, O Lord, in Days of Old. If you have a prayer concern for yourself or for others that you know, perhaps something involving not just your family and friends, but even this world of ours, I invite you to raise your hand during our benediction. Receive God's blessings. The Lord bless and keep you. The Holy Spirit enfold and empower you to grow in faith, love, and hope as disciples of Jesus Christ.